Okay, so good evening everyone, and welcome to this session. And we are going to start now. So this is the pain debates session number 3, and today we have another burning topic, which is MIPSI. Is it a good alternative to knee replacement? And on behalf of Mumbai Pain School, I welcome you all to this session. And I hope this debate brings to light lots of new information and changes your perspective in analyzing the issue. So we have two speakers today. I will introduce them. Both of them don't require an introduction. So we have with us Dr. Uttam Sidhai. He's a senior consultant in pain medicine at Dinanath Mangeshwar Hospital, Pune, and also the fellowship coordinator and honorary consultant at Bharati Vidyapeeth Medical College and Hospital, Pune. He is also the external examiner for many fellowship examinations and invited faculty in pain conferences across the globe. So welcome, Uttam sir.
Hello. Thank you very much.
And to speak against the motion, we have Dr. Babita Ghai. She is a senior professor at PGI Chandigarh, and she's a very well-known figure already, but still I will take this pleasure in introducing her. She's got very prominent international position. She's at the Developing Country Working Group member of IASP. She's a treasurer of Pain Education SIG at the IASP. She's editor for Acute Pain SIG at IASP and also the editorial board member for Pain Research Forum at IASP. She's also holding the IAPM executive position for now. And she's been the past joint secretary of ISSP. She's an avid researcher, having 125 international and 26 national publications to her credit. And she's got multiple grants with which she has done notable research and published it as well. She's got many awards, and some prominent ones are listed here. The COPS Award, which is a coveted award from ISA. She's done her TEDx talk as well in 2015. She's got an Excellence in Pain Research by WIP India at ICRA Jammu. And she's also got good quality publication awards in 2013, 16, 17, and 18 by the Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Medical Education and Research at Annual Research Days. She's also got a National Hindi Award by Ministry of Home Affairs for a low back pain booklet in Hindi. So I welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Siddharth. Thank you very much for your kind words.
So now let me introduce to you all the debate format. We have already completed this. I am introducing the session right now. And at 7:10, we'll start with for the motion. So this will be 10 minutes. Against the motion, the talk will be presented for another 10 minutes. Then we will have the rebuttal. This chance will be given to the against speaker first. And then at 7:35, we'll have for the following the same process. I will have the questions afterwards. I'll ask one question to each speaker. Then we will have audience questions as well. So we will, you all can raise your hands and we can choose two questions to each speaker. And I can allow to unmute one of you to unmute, and then we can ask. And then at 7:55, we will have closing comments and thanks. So everything else is clear. I will just explain the rebuttal rules. So rebuttal means they will be attempting to defend the opposing arguments and to defeat the supporting arguments without any new information addition. So this is the basic rule. And they may start for example, this, I have given just one example by saying that let's take a look at what we heard from the previous speaker and let's disagree with their points. And then they can list points in a very organized fashion, like 1, 2, 3. And this will be the rebuttal rules. And In the end, I will request the speakers to remind the audience of the multiple points which they have covered in the rebuttal. So time and discipline is extremely important because that will add not only grace but also rhythm to the debate. So for house rules, questions are most welcome in chat. Just raise hands to speak when there is question answer session. And one person will speak at a time. In the end, we'll also have a poll to decide the winner. So I think we can begin now. So I will first request Dr. Uttam to start sharing his screen. I will stop my screen share now. And sir, you can start sharing your screen and you can begin with your session.
Can you see my screen?
Sure, sir. I can see you. I can hear you.
Okay. Thank you, Siddharth. Good evening, everyone. This is an interesting thing to start this debate. And this is one of the most interesting topic and practical topic, I would say. So this is a debate between the MIPSI, what we call it, minimally invasive pain and spine interventions, and against the arthroplasty or knee replacement in osteoarthritic pain. He introduced me. I am a pain consultant in Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, Pune. I am a fellowship coordinator and associate professor in Bharati Vidyapeeth Medical College and Hospital. So when we are, I'm thankful to choose this again in the favor of motion, because I definitely vouch for the things that I do. I do MIPSI very regularly for the osteoarthritis knee. So I'm very confident to talk on this subject. Knee replacement cannot be the blanket treatment for the ONE, and MIPSI can definitely be an alternative for the surgery when we are talking about the osteoarthritis. My opponent, Dr. Bhavita Ghai, she is very senior and she is working in the PGI Chandigarh. She must be having a lot of that data against MIPSI, but the experience tells us that MIPSI is a very good alternative for osteoarthritis. I will give you one example. When we are traveling on the expressway, what is the data is saying? That it is very dangerous to travel on the expressway. There are high chances of accident. But what is your experience? Experience is that correct vehicle, correct speed and correct lane can avoid these accidents. So in when we are talking about the MIPSI, the correct procedure, correct stage and correct patient selection can avoid this surgery. We are progressive people. When we are talking about sending any letter, we used to send by envelope few years back. Now we are sending through the internet, that is wireless. Who thought of about this wireless 20 years back or 10 years back? When we are thinking about sending a message, we used to send by postcard. Now we are sending through the internet, so wireless. So nobody thought of this thing 20 years down the line, but now we are very used to all these things, and we know that it's a beneficial to everyone. It is saving our time and everything. When we are talking about the osteoarthritis, there are four stages in osteoarthritis: stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, stage 4. So most of the 75% are included in stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3, and only 25% falling in stage 4. So MIPSI is the treatment for majority. So early detection treatment will avoid the chances of arthroplasty. When we are conducting this debate, we should understand what is osteoarthritis. How many people are getting affected with this thing, and what is the pathophysiology of osteoarthritis. So osteoarthritis is a very common disease. It's a degenerative disease of progressive deterioration of articular cartilage, resulting in pain and severity and severe disability. So it is very common in old age people. It is estimated that 40 million people in Europe and 52.5 million people in US suffering from ONE. We don't have any clear-cut numbers in India, but I'm sure the numbers are more in India. It's a complex multifactorial disease affecting the old age people. This multifactorial is very important when we are treating the ONE. ONE is the largest joint consisting of bony structures, cartilage, ligaments, synovial membrane, and it's a high stress joint. We can classify into primary and secondary. And as I told you, it's a multifactorial entity. Causative factors like trauma, mechanical forces, inflammation, biochemical reactions, metabolic derangement. We should all consider all these things when we are treating the ONE. So this is a general picture of what is going on in the osteoarthritic knee. So when we are talking about the pathophysiology, it is basically a vascular, a neural, and a lymphatic non-immunogenic tissue consisting of 5% cells and 95% of extracellular matrix, which contains the cartilage, and there are laminin, lubricant, cartilage matrix protein, cartilage matrix, a lot of things are there inside the knee. The role of inflammation is very unclear, whether the inflammation starts, either inflammation, the ONE is because of the inflammation, or inflammation is because of the ONE, it is unclear. But inflammation is definitely there. So different inflammatory, it is different from the inflammatory arthritis. In inflammation of ONE, it's a chronic and low grade inflammation. And synovitis is a very common finding in ONE, and it is related to severity of the disease. So when we think about the ONE, the synovial fluid has found contained has many inflammatory mediators like C-reactive proteins, prostaglandins, cytokines, leukotrienes, and various growth factor, nitric oxide, and other components. And these components degrade the cartilage. So you just remember all these names, and then we can come. We can see in the MIPSI what is going, what the MIPSI do in the ONE. So it causes the destruction of the cartilage. Even they have found the white blood cells in the extracellular matrix. It is actually a protective mechanism, but eventually prolonged and dysregulated degree of inflammation can lead to tissue destruction. In animal studies, there are a lot of various growth factors like insulin-like, platelet-derived fibroblasts, and transforming growth factors B. These are also which are unfortunately altered in this patient in the OA and may become harmful to the joint because these are the good factors. So this is a very everybody are using this the Kellgren-Lawrence grading system. When we talk about the stage 1, stage 2, and stage 3, definitely MIPSI or conservative management is a treatment of choice. We don't have any doubt about the stage 4. If it's a severe knee osteoarthritis, then surgery is a treatment, but there is a gray area. In the stage 3, it's a gray area. There are a lot of unindicated surgeries that people are doing at the stage 3, which is not needed, and we can very well replace that thing with the MIPSI, and we can avoid the osteoarthritis. So the stage 3 is a very gray area. There is no doubt about in the stage 1 and stage 2 that conservative management and MIPSI is working well, very well documented. Evidences are there. Stage 4, we don't have any this thing doubt, but stage 3, we do have to say that MIPSI is a very good treatment. And it can replace the orthoplasty. I won't go into detail because this is not topic of discussion. That is conservative management. There are pharmacological treatment to treat ONE like NSAIDs, opioids, and other modalities of treatments are available in pharmacological treatment. Even the exercise and a lot of physiotherapy, even the weight reduction and lifestyle management. We can control this thing in stage 1 and stage 2, but we won't go into detail. Now we come to the main topic, that is MIPSI, that is minimally invasive pain and spine intervention procedures, which includes intra-articular steroid injection, hyaluronic acid injection, prolotherapy, PRP, cooled RF, and newer modalities like stem cells, which is under study. So unfortunately, we have to include this intra-articular steroid in this thing because it has got level 1A evidence. And a lot of societies have included into the guidelines. So, but we are using the triamcinolone, methylprednisolone, dexamethasone intraarticularly, but the effect of this intraarticular injection is short term and could facilitate tissue atrophy, joint destruction, and cartilage degeneration. But and the prolotherapy, I will not say it is exclusively we can use and it can replace the orthoplasty or knee replacement. But when we are thinking that the main pain is because of the ligaments and other surrounding structures, then prolotherapy plays an important role. As a pain physician, we need to provide a lot of references, and we have to conduct a lot of studies to prove that MIPSI is very good in ONE. Prolotherapy in this, we give dextrose and local anesthetic around the knee joint. It will strengthen the ligaments and surrounding structures. So there are a few references available on prolotherapy, but the main important thing is right now is hyaluronic acid, which is a visco supplement. It's a glycosaminoglycan, which is a joint lubricant and shock absorber. right now the intra-articular hyaluronic acid is currently indicated only as a symptom modifying treatment for the ONE, but there are a lot of studies available which shows that it is chondroprotective and it has got anti-inflammatory properties. So what is the basic cause of osteoarthritis and what is the cause of pain is the inflammation. So if it is anti-inflammatory, it will take care of pain, and if it is because there is a destruction of cartilage and this HA is a chondroprotective, so it can it can help in regenerating the cartilage. So these are the primary studies, but only main thing when you are using HA, you should understand that the molecular weight is very important when you are using HA. It should be between 500 to 4,000 kilodaltons. So if you are using less than 500, it is not going to help the patient. If you are using more than 6,000, it is also not going to help the patient. So HA is better than the steroid injection intra-articularly. It has there are a lot of studies. Now we will concentrate on the PRP, because my main aim, our aim is to tell the people that MIPSI can replace the arthroplasty. So PRP is a newer thing, and it is very important right now and gives excellent results in stage 3 osteoarthritis. It's a platelet are unnucleated cells which derive from the megakaryocytes, and when platelets are activated, the growth factors contained in the alpha granules of the platelet respond to in a localized and site-specific manners. So the major growth factors and factor families in PRP that involved in the OA treatment include tissue growth factors, insulin-like growth factor, which I was talking in the pathophysiology of osteoarthritis. They are present when they are increased in number when we are injecting the PRP. Those are tissue growth factors. This insulin-like growth factors, BMP, PDGF, VEGF, EGF, and HGF. So it has got very, very important mechanism inside the joint. The TGFB has been identified as one of the most important factor in cartilage regeneration because of its role in proliferation and differentiation of chondrocytes. IGF is also important for promoting chondrocyte mitosis and extracellular matrix synthesis. BMP assists in chondrocyte migration. FGF has a major role in cartilage repair. PGDF has a role in increasing chondrocyte proliferation, and VEGF has a vascular structure formation and regeneration. So it will give nutrition to the joint. So in a way, when we are injecting PRP, we are taking care of everything that is happening in the joint inside the osteoarthritic joint. Now we will come to the cooled RF. It's a big hit right now. Why we are doing this arthroplasty? One first and most important thing is pain. Disability comes in a very late stage. The people are doing the arthroplasty for the pain. If we take away the pain of the patient, then what is the need of doing this arthroplasty? So the cooled RF is one of the most important and breakthrough treatment, I would say, in the management of osteoarthritis, especially pain. So what we are doing in cooled RF, people have tried the conventional RF, but the cooled RF is very good because it has got a big lesion and missing the nerve, the chances of missing that nerve is very less because the nerve is very thin. The diameter of the nerve is very less. So it is creating a very big lesion. So the chances of ablating that nerve are high. And we are doing it under the ultrasound, and we are doing it in the fluoroscopy. So which are the major nerve which we are ablating in the cooled radio frequency ablation is superior medial and inferior medial and superolateral genicular nerves. These are genicular nerves. These are the branches of the sciatic, that is tibial nerve. And this cooled RF is targeted thermal damage of the nerve structures to interrupt the transmission of pain signals.
Dr. Uttam, sir, time is up, sir. So please,
one second.
Yes, yes.
So I would say because we are doing it for the pain, and the cooled RF is giving good. These are the references. Disadvantage we will talk later. And so according to me, the combination of PRP and CRFA can be the game-changing intervention in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. So now we move to the against the motion speaker. Madam, should I share your slides?
Yes, please. You share my slides, please.
Yes.
I would first of all mention to the audience that my slide was not been able to share because I have a new Apple.
But Siddharth, not to worry.
Share my slides. Yes. I do have slides on my screen, which is side by side. I'll also be, you know, that would also guide me. And I'll see that Siddharth is also onto the right slides.
Ma'am, but I think we can see. Achha, okay, Uttam sir's screen, I can see. Okay, sure. So I will start sharing.
Should I stop my sharing?
Yeah, now it is stopped. Okay. So now I will share the slide. Ma'am, can you see your slides?
Not right now. Yes, I can see it. And can you make it a screen share that full screen?
Yes. So I have made it full screen. Just let me know next when to move to the next slide. I will do that.
Yeah. My time is 7:23. So first of all, I would really, you know, appreciate the effort of Dr. Siddharth being taken for this debate and all the academic activities he's doing. And I am also thankful for him to be choosing me for this debate. Initially, because I felt that for any academic activity, I should be putting my best. So I was slightly taken aback because this was speaking against the notion of what we do, that is as a pain physician. But then as an academician, I realized how to present this debate, which is a very simple thing. I found at the last that it is very simple to say that MIPSI is not a good alternative to knee replacement. And thank you, Siddharth, for choosing me for this debate, because I hope I will be doing the justice to this. Moving forward, I don't have any disclosures or conflicts of interest. Especially, I would like to say that I am not an orthopedician because I'm speaking against the MIPSI and I am a hardcore pain physician. The views over here are academician views. So over the next 9 minutes, what shall I be discussing? That what is the need of this debate, of for which Dr. Uttam has already done a part of my job. So I'll be just taking one slide to speak about the impact and the epidemiology of OA&E, how huge is this problem, and to prove that MIPSI is not an alternative to TKR. And I would say that I have already won the debate once listening to Dr. Uttam. So why the need of discussing this debate? We all know that there is a very, the OA&E is a highly prevalent entity. I'm sorry. I am moving my own slides and I thought I'm doing that.
Yeah. Ma'am, just tell me when to move. Yeah.
Next slide, please.
Yes.
Next, please. So OA&E is highly prevalent worldwide. I would say that its prevalence in India is reported to be 28 to 32%. These are the two good articles from India. One is from Dr. Dureja and one is from Mumbai itself. The financial implication of it is huge. The financial implication from India is not reported, but from the Canadian or the US data, the financial implication are pretty high. And when this OA&E becomes chronic, it impacts all aspects of life like any other chronic pain. Next, please. So it is of paramount importance with this huge entity that we offer a directed treatment that are safe, cost effective, and beneficial to the patient. Next, please. To consider that MIPSI is a good alternative to knee replacement, I would say no, and a big no. Now I'll prove why do I say. Next, please. With Dr. Uttam stating that there are indication for MIPSI and there are indication for TKR. When I say that the indications are altogether different and in stage 3 of gray zone, where the MIPSI can be considered as an alternative, with that statement, I would say that I've already won the debate. So let's move. What exactly is a good alternative? Next, please. What exactly is a good alternative in medical literature? A good alternative in medical literature is that when the modalities in questions used for the treatment of a particular disease, the results are similar for the outcome. Within the entity in our question, the outcomes are pain, stiffness, physical functioning, vitality, social functioning, and health-related quality of life. Dr. Uttam was focusing only on the pain. However, the outcomes are all these together, and chronic pain is not one just entity where we would like to just reduce the pain. Final outcome is the functionality of the patient to be improvised. Next, please. So when is the TKR indicated? According to American Association of Orthopedic Surgeons, TKR is indicated in severe knee pain that limits everyday activity. When the pain is moderate to severe while resting as well as during the day and night, it is long-lasting knee inflammation and swelling is associated, and there is no or inadequate pain relief by the conservative management and other modalities have not worked. Moving further, next please. So TKR is actually indicated when MIPC is inadequate or failed. So it is the end of line treatment. How can it have been the alternative? Next, please. So I would say that TKR has no good alternative, and it has no, in fact, it does not even have an equivalent alternative. So now let's see how, why do I say that? Next, please. That TKR is not an alternative to MIPC. When we talk about TKR and the outcome of the TKR, it provides complete pain relief, it provides complete functionality, it provides complete vitality, and it provides cost. It is actually a cost-effective way of doing as compared to the MIPC. What happens in MIPC? So I would say that the weight is more towards the TKR. In MIPC, there is never a complete pain relief. There is never a complete functionality. There is never a complete vitality. And we might have to repeat MIPC many times during the course of the treatment, and hence adding on to the cost effectiveness. Next, please. Now talk about the evidence of that MIPC is not an alternative to TKR. I'll talk about the TKR and its outcome, MIPC and its outcome. Next, please. And I would talk about the quality of the evidence taken from the systematic and meta-analysis from the very good reputed journal with highest possible impact factor. Next, please. Okay, TKR. Very recently in Lancet 2019, American Association of Orthopedic Surgeon has published their notes wherein they have reported that over 90% of the TKR are still functioning after 15 years. Do we get such type of results with MIPC ever? No. These patients did have a significant improvement in pain, stiffness, functional, physical function, vitality, and social functioning, as well as they had a very high quality of life. So what this is, has turned out to be a very cost effective management of the OA knee. Next, please. I'll talk about the most commonly performed procedure, that is intra-articular corticosteroid injection. 2015 Cochrane data review, next please, has analyzed 27 low quality heterogeneous RCT, and they found that at 1 month, there has been only improvement of only one VAS, as an NNT needed for this is 8, which is pretty high. And the effect is wanes off, and it is absent at 36 weeks. WOMAC also has improved only for 1 to 2 weeks, and the effect goes off by 13 weeks. Hence, they concluded that it has a poor quality of heterogeneous studies. And next, please, despite speculations of early pain relief, the effect is not long lasting. Moving further, next please. Adverse, if in fact intra-articular corticosteroid has been reported to have adverse event. Next, Siddharth. And these have been reported to flare up. Again, this is a very highly reputed journal, JAMA 27, which reported that the infection rate was as high as 25%. In fact, it has also caused the progression of knee OA. So, and it has also been associated with systemic side effects. Next, please. In 2019, Nature published that intra-articular corticosteroid before TKA might increase the risk of postoperative infection. Hence, with the growing evidence, the utility of intra-articular corticosteroid is questioned, which is the commonest procedure we perform. Next, please. Now I'll talk about intra-arterial hyaluronic acid, which Dr. Uttam has also discussed in detail as a one of the regenerative modality. Intra-articular hyaluronic acid has been compared with either multiple comparators, whether the placebo or with the NSAIDs or with the intra-articular corticosteroid, and it has not shown good results. It has demonstrated some improvement, while the others have not demonstrated. The results have been lackluster throughout the different studies. Three studies compared to oral NSAID has shown no significant difference in the outcome. So systematic reviews of intra-articular hyaluronidase has shown that the results have been good till 25 months. However, multiple injections were required as high as 12 to 15 in many of the patients. So, and also there has been a very variability of hyaluronic acid with different molecular weight being used, different modality, different methodologies being used, different guide, different duration being used. So the current guidelines have reflected the methodological challenges of available primary evidence. Next, please. So even in the Indian, from the Indian perspective, recent Indian data published, they have shown that there is a lack of standard clinical practice recommendations on intra-articular hyaluronidase in India, and regarding the patient profile chosen, as well as the results, and there is an ambiguity amongst practitioners, so it is not included in the guideline. Moving on to the another regenerative modality, that is platelet-rich plasma. It has been recommended by AASO in 2013. However, again, the robust evidence for the PRP is not there. It has been considered to be superior to the other current modalities, however, not as a replacement to TKR. And one point, it is not covered by the insurance. Next, please. Genicular nerve blocks have again... Next, please. No, platelet-rich plasma. I'm sorry. Siddharth, next, please.
This one?
Okay. There is a genicular nerve blocks. Again, there is a limited evidence regarding its benefit. The studies are small. Dr. Uttam has talked about cooled RF. Again, the cooled RF has been done on a very, very small number of patients. If we collect the whole evidence of systematic review, not more than 120 patients could be collected for the cooled RF, which is very difficult to come up to any conclusion. So in MIPSI, systematic review have attempted to assess many of the injection therapies, and studies were heterogeneous, definitely of very low quality. Between studies, each therapy has been used with variety of doses, strength, preparation, and various interval, making the statistical significance, in fact, the clinical significance also too difficult to achieve. Many studies did not use a control population, and while often there has been a poorly defined protocol for the studies, in fact, there is no study which has compared TKR with MIPSI, like, next please. Like recently, MIPSI, that is the nerve root block, has been compared with the microdiscectomy. So one procedure is surgical and one procedure is MIPSI, over where the MIPSI has been shown in a very, very stringently done methodology superior to the surgical microdiscectomy. Do we have any evidence wherein MIPSI has been compared to the TKR? Say, even in the gray zone of stage three, no, we do not have any evidence which would support MIPSI. Hence, MIPSI, next please. A clinical practice guideline direct treatment based on the cost effectiveness. Much of the evidence is of short effect, and it may be intermediate for few. Repeated interventions are required. It may not be cost effective, and higher level of evidence will be necessary to tease out the superior therapy in futures. And as a, this definitely cannot be considered as, next please, as an alternative to TKR. So to conclude, MIPSI, next please. MIPSI is not at all an alternative to TKR. In fact, it is not even an equivalent or a good alternative to TKR. It may be considered as a step of management of OA NEEM during the continuum of the treatment, or it may be considered as an adjunct or relative to TKR, wherein either the TKR is not possible because of the comorbidities of the patient, or wherein patient is not willing to TKR. Thank you very much. Next, please. I would end my debate over here saying that MIPSI is not an alternative to TKR.
Great. So I think now, ma'am, you have the chance of the first rebuttal. So if you would like to just start your rebuttal, please.
Okay. So my first rebuttal is on the point Dr. Uttam has said that MIPSI is indicated in stage three, stage one and two, there is no doubt. When he mentioned himself that TKR is indicated in stage four. So he has already accepted that the indication of MIPSI and the indication of TKR are together different. If the indications are different, how can we consider one modality as an alternative to TKR? That is my first question. Regarding the prolotherapy, which I did not include in my slide, and I thought that things would go very long, about the prolotherapy is considered as one of the regenerative therapy. It has not been reported to have major harm. However, the data, especially reported in the scientific report, which has an impact factor of 6, they have done the systematic review and they could not perform analysis, meta-analysis in 2016, reported that prolotherapy effects are, the results of this meta-analysis are insufficient to say that prolotherapy helps. Now, the third point is, do I have to give 3 rebuttal?
No, I mean, there's no limit, guys. This was just an example.
Okay. He mentioned correct indication. Again, as I said in the first go, that when it is correctly indicated, MIPSI has a different indication, and correctly indicated, TKR has an absolutely different indications. Last but not the least is, he is mentioning that MIPSI is focusing on the pain relief. We should focus on the pain relief. No, the outcome is that the pain relief and that pain relief leading to functional improvement. OA knee is a degenerative disease and the pain has occurred because there is a degeneration or inflammation. If you do not take out that progressive OA or the degenerative entity, obviously, getting only pain relief will not improve the functionality. Hence, we should not just focus on the pain relief. We should focus on functionality improvement as well as the improvement of health-related quality of life. I end my rebuttal here.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for sticking to the time limit. So now we move on to the rebuttal by the speaker for the motion. That is Dr. Uttam Sidhai, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. I knew that you from PGI Chandigarh, you have a lot of evidences, a lot of references, a lot of things in your hand. But I am not we talked about the OAA in general. We are not talking about the OAA at the stage four. There is a gray zone. You should accept that there is a gray zone where the people are doing unindicated knee replacement. And where there is comes the role of a pain physician, that is stage three. So we are not talking about stage four. We are talking about OANE in general. So MIPSI is the replacement. Will you advise knee replacement at stage one? No, we won't advise. We will go for the MIPSI. So that's why we are in general we are talking about the OANE. We are not talking about a stage four. And I accept that for the stage four OANE. The arthroplasty or the knee replacement is the treatment of choice, but we are talking mainly about the gray zone. So that is the first point. When you were talking about the evidences and references, you said you have compared hyaluronic acid with the steroid, right? But there is no doubt now, and even I said the steroid is not a treatment of choice right now because it's short-lived. I'm talking about because you talk about MIPSI will not take care of inflammation. When I was talking about the inflammatory things, what is happening in the joint, and I told you a lot of enzymes which are released from the platelet, they are taking care of the inflammation as well. And the second thing is pain, the cooled RF. So I am talking about the combination of PRP and cooled RF. So it will take care of the inflammation as well as it will take care of the pain. So it will improve the functionality of the patient, and it will improve the painful knee also. When we are talking about the surgery, there are a lot of reports and a lot of papers suggesting that 15 to 30% people are unhappy after the knee replacement. And almost 14 to 53% patients, they have persistent discomfort. And in fact, in one paper, there are 7 to 50% report poor knee function after the knee replacement. So if you're talking about the MIPSI is not inadequate pain relief, then what the TKR is also doing? TKR is also giving you inadequate pain relief. A lot of people are suffering from neuropathic pain after the this thing. There are a lot of nerve injuries, peroneal injuries after the knee replacement. So if the patient comes with the stage 3 in a gray zone, will you advise the patient to go for the knee replacement just because he is having pain? I don't agree with this thing. We will go for the MIPSI, and we have a lot of experience that this combination of PRP and pooled RF will give a lot of good results in the, and this is of the responsibility of the pain physician to present the paper and give a lot of data to the international community to say that, because considering the Indian scenario, the lot of people can't afford this replacement therapy, knee replacement, because it's not that cost effective for the Indian population. So MIPSI can be cost effective for the Indian population. So we should conduct a lot of studies and present this data in front of the international community. And as a professor in PGI, I request you to conduct all these things in your institute, because it's a teaching institute, and that will give a lot of boost to the MIPSI, and that will give boost to the pain practitioners.
May I?
So, but that's the last one. Okay, I allow you.
No, but may I say something, because there are many things in the rebuttal which he is
actually post rebuttal. The talk is not allowed, but I will allow. Okay. So I will allow you to have one statement, and then we end the thing.
One statement.
Yes.
There are many things which I wanted to say, but one statement is. When am I saying, Dr. Uttam, that I would say that TKR to be done in the...
Just a second. Sorry to interrupt you.
I'm sorry.
I'll just mute the participants, and you can unmute yourself again. Yes, please speak.
During any time of the presentation, did I give any impression that I will allow to the TKR to be conducted in stage 4? No. So that is why I'm saying TKR, the MIPSI is not a replacement of TKR. It is the continuum of the treatment. That's it.
Okay. You get also one statement. Last one, ma'am. No more statements.
Just a one question, madam. If you are saying a 75%, 70 years old man comes to you just only for the pain, without any disability, only for the pain, will you suggest that patient to go ahead with the osteoarthritis? If it is stage 4, say it's a stage 4 disease, but it's the only complaint is pain, what will you do to that patient? That is only one question to you.
His only complaint would not be pain only. His complaint would be functionality.
Patient comes to you only for the pain, but people are doing right now osteoarthritis, grade 4, only
that
pain.
That is where the data might be wrong. The AAOSA data from Lancet, this has a data of more than 1 lakh patients, more than 1 million patients. If you're talking about somebody who's up any data, which I did not, you have said 7 to 50% of the patients are not satisfied. This is the way the TKR might, the indication of the TKR or the procedure might not have been right. I do not agree that 50%, yes, 10% of the patient might be having chronic pain. Agreed, acceptable. But 50% of the patient having continuous pain after TKR is not at all acceptable.
Okay. So I think we should stop the debate now. Thank you so much, both of you. We'll move to the next portion, sure. Which is I will pose one question to each one of you. Actually, I'll just sum up some of the questions which have been coming up. So, Dr. Uttam, can you just sum up your practical experience in doing, these MIPSIs in one line? That what are the best indication for MIPSIs, and which are the best one which you are doing, just in one line?
See, right now I'm doing MIPSI for stage 2 and stage 3, and I'm not doing a single MIPSI. I'm doing the combination of PRP as well as Kulif. That is cool radio frequency ablation, and that is giving me excellent results.
Okay, thank you. Now my second the question is to Babita ma'am, and ma'am, this is regarding because I know you are not doing TKRs, but just your clinical experience or your views on what are the majority of TKRs which are happening around you. Means I'm sure you must be seeing these patients before and after, or maybe as part of the anesthesia department as well. So what are these patients actually having? Are they having a grade 3, grade 4 arthritis, or I mean, just they cannot walk, or I mean, just your comments.
I would say I'm at PGI-MER, or even if I talk about my corporate setups here, Fortis and Mohali, none of the patient is even operated in stage 3. Stage 3, so all the patients are operated in stage 4, or very few patients in stage 3. That is, none of the patient is stage 1, stage 2, absolutely not. Stage 3, the functionality is maintained and the pain can be managed with MIPSI. No way they go. But then if the functionality is affected and MIPSI is providing, or the conservative management is providing, inadequate or no pain relief.
Great. Thank you. So I think that answers many of the questions for the audiences as well. Now, I will like to ask the audience to come up with their questions. Guys, please raise your hands. I want to just unmute you. Come on the camera and I will give preference to those people who will raise their hands first. And I will allow to unmute you. You can also come on the camera. Okay. So, okay. So first question will be from Dr. Shilpa. Yes. Over to you, madam. I have unmuted you.
Yeah. Sir. Hello, sir. It was a nice debate. My question is, suppose we go with MIPS, and suppose we diminish the pain of the patient, but that is somewhere a protective mechanism also for the joint. Like when we feel pain, there is inflammation and there is some problem in the joint. And if we are going to diminish the pain, we are not able to diminish the inflammation and we are able to walk without pain, but it will hamper the joint more. Isn't it so?
So I will allow all these questions, which are pro questions, to be taken by Dr. Uttam, and against question to be taken by Dr. Babita till the end of the debate, when we will have closing comments from both of you. Okay. Dr. Uttam, please take the question. Yes, yes, please.
Yeah, even in the pro question, if I feel something to be added.
Sure, sure. You are most welcome.
Thank you.
Okay.
So we are ablating only 3 nerves. We are not ablating. There are 9 or 10 nerves supplying the knee joint. So we are not touching the obturator. We are only ablating the 3 nerves. So Charcot joint, what you are talking about, that the sensation will go off, it doesn't go like that.
Okay. Dr. Shilpa, you are talking about pain being a defense mechanism.
Yes, so ma'am.
When there is a chronic pain, it doesn't become a defense mechanism only. It becomes a disease also.
It's yeah. Yeah.
About... Yeah. So acute pain is always a defensive mechanism, but not the chronic pain. Chronic pain leads to lots of impact on the normal life. If the pain is continued in the early OA, what is the management of early OA? Doing exercises, strengthening the muscles. If your patient has pain and the patient is not able to perform the exercises because of the pain, what would happen? The disease would progress faster or lesser?
It will progress faster.
Fine. So I answer your question that relieving pain at that point will not lead to a progression of OA knee?
All right, ma'am. Got it.
Great. So
thank you.
Now we move on to the next question. Dr. Shilpa, I'm going to mute you now. Okay, you muted yourself. Great. So this question, I'm going to unmute Dr. Hussein Musa. So please forgive me if I have not pronounced your name correctly. I am going to ask you to start your video also. So you can unmute yourself now and you can speak.
Hello, how are you?
Yes, I can hear you. Good.
Yes, yes, good. I had more than 6 years of experience for treatment of knee osteoarthritic changes with pulsed radio frequency. for saphenous nerve and superior geniculate nerve, and it is very effective and good result. I have no experience with calling pulsed radio frequency. Any study comparing between pulsed radio frequency and calling radio frequency, please? Thanks.
Thank you.
There are very less studies comparing the, there are studies like they are compared, they have compared with the conventional radio frequency, even the pulse radio frequency and the cooling. But there are chances of missing the nerves are more in conventional radio frequency than the cooled RF. So cooled RF, according to me, the cooled RF is one of the best treatment. Only the thing is that the cost effectiveness of the, that is, it's very costly at this stage in India. But the, I have found a, another option in that. Then if you are doing the conventional, you can do the bipolar. So bipolar RF will create the bigger lesion. And the study-wise, we can conduct the study, but there are studies in the available which they have compared with the conventional RF with the cooled RF. The results of cooled RF are much, much better than the conventional RF.
Thanks.
May I now add on? Dr. Uttam has said rightly.
Thank
Uttam,
you.
The only one thing is that you said that you have a very good results from the cooled RF. I would suggest you to please publish that, because say this is my personal experience saying that I have a good result. Good result means what? Until unless we show the word. Now about the question to Dr. Hussain. Dr. Hussain, there is a recent meta-analysis being published for the radio frequency for the knee, which is one of the author I know is Dr. Anuj Bhatia. Okay, in that case, that is a very recent one, 2018 or something, wherein they have reported that cooled RF definitely is much better than conventional RF. PRF versus cooled RF, enough data is not available. About the PRF, the results were that the chances of muscle weakness was less. Again, the data is still not very large amount. We, in our experience, have conducted a recently a study wherein PRF was compared with the intra-articular injection. Frankly speaking, PRF was compared with the local anesthetic and steroid injection of all the three nerves. The fourth nerve we do not block because of the motor, the lateral inferior, we do not block. And to our surprise, when you get biased, you know, but then this was a completely blinded study. To my surprise, results were similar for the PRF as well as for the for the nerve injection of local anesthetic and steroid. We followed them till 4 months and we have sent this to publication, probably is getting accepted. So when we expect the results are good, we have to do a good research to say, yes, the results are good.
Thanks.
Cooled RF, I don't have experience.
Now, fortunately, we have fellows in Bharti. Now we can publish this results of cooled RF and we can publish the paper.
Great. Dr. Hussain, I will also request you to publish your particular data, because even on pulsed RF, the data is quite less. So I will request you also, because 6 years is a big time. And if you are doing, I'm sure you will have done a lot of cases. So please combine them and make the criteria same, because if the endpoints are the same, as Madam showed very nicely in one slide, then we can compare the, you know, the techniques. So that will be great help to all of us. Great. Okay.
So you can check in the chat box also. I have sent you.
Yes. Yes. One reference, a couple of references have been posted in the chat box. And I think that will be great to review. Great. So now we'll take one last question before we go for the poll. And we decide the winner. Formally, we have to decide one winner. Okay.
Just one thing. There has been many questions in the chat box. These people would have been, waiting for long. They did not raise their hand.
So I will take all those questions. I'll take all those questions. No problem. So the last question for which I'm allowing somebody to come on live is this one. Okay, Dr. Sanjog, I have unmuted you, and then we'll go on to the chat questions. Okay.
So good evening, everyone.
Actually, my question is not my question. My question is of the patients. And the patients always ask कि ये जो प्रोसीजर है इससे हमारी बीमारी दूर हो जाएगी या ये मैनेज होगा. So my question is, so we are comparing these two things, TKR and MIPSI, but we are comparing it for the cure of osteoarthritis or just for the management of osteoarthritis?
What they are doing with the surgery?
So basically, they are removing the pathology, whatever the inflammation, degeneration is there. So they are replacing that joint with the artificial thing. So
why patients are unhappy after the TKR?
Yes, so that is a totally that's the side effect which is
you have to find out what is the basic reason of the pain. There are a lot of patients who have neuropathic pain also in the knee, and the patient undergo.
So let me intervene here. Unless there is a varus deformity, let me be very clear. If you see the books, they write TKR is a what we are doing is neurotomy. So it is also a procedure which takes away the nerves, and that is the mechanism. You study the mechanism of pain relief, and that is the same denervation. It is a denervation procedure. Okay. So I'm sorry, as a host, I'm not supposed to intervene, but this same question is asked to me as well. And I have gone one step ahead, and I will, we're just going to have a webinar very soon. And there I'll reveal one technology, which is very simple, but if you do it, we have done a lot of cases using that. And even in stage 4, you can get good results with MIPSI. So I'll tell you those secrets in that webinar. And, but the philosophy is the same. TKR is a denervation procedure. If it would not have been a denervation procedure, the results would have been different. And if you see, there are various types of TKR. I'm trying to get somebody to speak on this also. And all the pain physicians should, our job is even more difficult if most of us are pain physicians. So if some orthopedic colleague is also listening, then that's great. Because our job is to give results to the patient. Our job is not to, defend one technique or become a slave of one technique. So as a doctor, as a solemnly, we take the oath. So our allegiance should lie to the patient and not to the technique or even to the branch. So first preference is to the patient. So it is essentially a denervation procedure. And unless if there is a varus or valgus deformity, which is more than 15 degrees, which cannot be corrected, then it becomes the only option, or patient suffers, whatever. So I think this will cover this. You go through a literature and search. It is actually a denervation procedure. So that is also a joint denervation.
Siddharth, it is the way you said, unless it is a varus or valgus, the joint space is reduced. The joint space has more of friction. And that is why we consider it as the end of line treatment. So TKR, because I was so confused that why to choose this topic, because I am from an academic institute. Okay. I am 100% sure what we do. Our orthopedician has so much of burden that they shove off the patient. They find one excuse not to do. Okay. This patient is old. This patient has cardiac problem. They try to find out excuses to not to do, and hence we are doing lots of MIPSI. But why we have to understand that if indicated properly, then TKR is a functional procedure. Okay, it is. If somebody is doing when it is not indicated, I would be very surprised to see.
The question was, I agree with you, but the question was that whether we are addressing the pathology or whether we, so this answer also lies in the same question which was asked by the first speaker.
Yes.
Because they don't understand, even the pain, many pain physicians are still learning about this fact that pain becomes a disease when it is chronic pain itself. So I take many lectures for GPs, and one of the favorite lecture is pain is a symptom, sign and a disease. So this should be taught to all of us, and then this question will not arise at all. So patient, especially the village patients, they say, "Arey, usse to TK se kya hoga? Usse sirf thoda thode din ka aaram hoga," and then again the patient will have. But On the other hand, even a successful, very good, best done TKR can have some issues after some time. So it is not about whether
the answer is that MIPSI, barring still not proven, regenerative therapies are not still proven that they would regenerate. MIPSI is not taking the disease away.
No, it's a degenerative disease, so it's not possible.
Okay, great. So I think some great points to think. Hello. And I think all of you, I have got all of you started. So I'm sure definitely you will think more on this and be more cautious and more careful with your patients.
I'm sorry, I missed out slightly for a few seconds. What was that?
Nothing, ma'am, nothing much. I just mentioned that this is a food for thought. So I think good. That's why it's a matter of debate and we should know the fine finish of where to draw the line. Great. So I think we move on to the audience questions now. And we have Dr. Lohit's hand also, but I will, Dr. Lohit, let me finish first the audience questions.
Lohit has written the first question itself.
Okay, so let me unmute you then. You can ask quickly, Dr. Lohit, from you. Let's hear from you.
Hello, ma'am. Very nice discussion. Thanks for the debate. And I have been working with a lot of centers who have been doing TKR, a lot of TKR. So in my personal experience, like if the patient gets infected after TKR, it is a hell for the patient. That is one thing I have noticed. So as the regards for TKR, like can we do genicular nerve ablation as an alternative if the patient is not willing for TKR or if they are having multiple comorbidities and not fit for TKR? And also as a pre this one for TKR, like if genicular nerve ablation is done and then if they undergo rehabilitation program because they'll be pain-free and their muscle strengthening can be done prior to the TKR. That is my question.
Okay. Lohit, very good question, but let me understand the question. Your question is,
he's made a statement and then also made a question. So statement is understood. He's working and he's doing genicular ablations. And his question is that before the procedure, if we do this thing and reduce the pain, maybe then the patient can go for strengthening and then maybe the results can be better.
So should I take this first and Uttam can add on? Okay, Dr. Lohit, there is only one study where they have used goniometer to assess the strengthening of the muscle after genicular nerve block. In our setup, we are actually conducting a thesis, in fact, finished a thesis, wherein we gave genicular nerve block and assessed the strengthening of the muscle and compared it with the control group, that is placebo. We did see improvement both in the extensor as well as the flexor. So that proves that we can improvise. Hence, it can be used pre-TKR to strengthen the muscle. However, data is only one study and what our study is, we are about to publish.
So if my experience, I have tried with my mother, she underwent TKR and I give the genicular, it doesn't help much. Because when you are doing TKR, there is a strengthening, a stretching of the muscle also. Because there is a shortening and then you are doing TKR and there is a stretching and there is a lot of pain. And there is a cut section is way above the condylar this thing. The cut section of the TKR is way above this thing and they are drilling in the marrow. So even the marrow pressure increases and that causes a lot of pain. So as such, if you are doing the genicular nerve block before the TKR, I think it won't help the patient much.
No. Are you talking about just before TKR? Then
I think strengthening cannot happen just before. It needs some time. So I think 4 weeks or something. So, yeah.
So my answer was given some time before, like 1, 2, 3, 4 months before and do strengthen the muscle, maybe the outcome would be better. But again, there is no study to prove this.
So guys, those of you who are searching for topics of collaboration, so I think get your orthopedician on board and they have lots of patients who are, even it is difficult for them to convince the patient to undergo the procedure. So just get in touch with them and say, okay, let's collaborate on this. And maybe you can do in some of these patients genicular and then
wait for some time.
Go for TKR. I think that should theoretically help. And it should also reduce the incidence of TKR failures, because if you are taking, you know, strengthening the muscle and improving the joint function, and that's what they want after the TKR immediately afterwards. So that would help, definitely help, I feel. But then, of course, it has to be researched.
This is known as prehabilitation before surgery, and you would find many articles of prehabilitation.
Yes. So that's a very good idea, Dr. Lohit, I think. Okay, next question is, I'll take a couple of questions from the chat box as well. So,
Dr. Nandita Mehta.
Yes, so Dr. Nandita Mehta, ma'am, from Jammu, she has asked a question for, please comment on the age for doing TKR if the patient presents with OA grade 3 very early in life.
Okay.
I think that's a question for an orthopedician to answer, though. But
I might take it, though I am not an orthopedician.
Yeah, so the next phase, I am sure I will, because this was the first of its kind debate. So next time, I am sure I will, I am now well, much more well prepared to get an orthopedician
vote.
That will be.
It was a very good thought for me to be getting a debate against what I believe, you know, against what I do. Again, but the point is that it is, we have to realize that it is a continuum of when TKR is, there is no replacement of TKR because it is indicated in a very different patients. So to take this answer, to take this question, Dr. Nandita, if the patient is early in the life and has got grade 3, I would not jump over to suggesting TKR. If they come for the second opinion, I will definitely try to manage with MIPSI and different regenerative modality. So, because there is a lifespan of any artificial procedure, okay? So this patient, if comes in the early, say 40s, the lifespan of most of the TKRs is studied till 20 years. So we do not know, he might need a resurgery. So it is usually a thought process that we would delay as much as possible.
Dr. Uttam, your take?
Yeah, I agree with ma'am.
Okay, great. So I think let's move on to the next comment. So this is from Dr. Mukesh Vakil. He's listened to our comments and then he's asking if, I think he's asking if his comment reads, denervation only, then not even a single patient will need relief for post-operative pain. So he says that if TKR is, you know, cutting the nerves, because you cut the whole portion from below and the nerves are cut. So then why there is post-operative pain? And in fact, many of us or many of the attendees as an anesthesiologist must have seen that the surgeon used to fire patient if he or she complains of post-operative pain, telling them that I have cut the nerves during surgery. How can you have any pain? So this is just a comment which is in the comment, so comment box. So I think you can, your take on this, Dr. Uttam.
So the causative factors for the pain are multiple. That's what I'm trying to tell you. So maybe when they're putting the cement, also the marrow also expands and that also causes pain. So it is not only the and what we are ablating, we are ablating the medial portion of the nerve, the medial portion of the joint. Or and in the anterior portion of the joint, when we are ablating the superior and medial and
superior lateral inferomedial. Yes.
So the pain is not getting generated only from that area. Pain is getting generated because it's a valgus or valgus deformity. That even the joint, even the muscles are the length of the muscle is also reduced. When your whole knee is in line, then there is stretching of the muscles also. So pain is only not because we are cutting the bone at that area and not because of the incision. There are multiple factors why a patient is getting pain. So only the genicular will not help in the post-operative pain. You have to go for the femoral sciatic.
Okay.
Or maybe the sometimes.
So I think these are the, now we don't take any more questions. And
just for this, Dr. Uttam is right that anterior and medial pain is taken care by the genicular nerve. The posterior pain is not been, and there is nociceptive pain when we go for the postoperative pain. We have many other factors. The whole of the muscle is being cut. The skin is cut. Denervation does not mean that the pain is taken away.
If this was this easy, then everybody will just cut the nerves and then, you know, get away with the pain. And there would be no sensitization. There will be nothing like phantom pain. There will be nothing like. So there are lots of things. And I feel that this requires all in all a basic understanding of the first four chapters of all pain books, which everybody just skips.
Just one thing is somebody is asking a very valid question. What is the practical experience of speakers regarding their debate in topics of MIPC?
Ma'am, I think I will, you can just cover in one or two lines in closing comments, all this.
For this or closing comment answer or?
For this, anyway, I'm going to ask you to cover this in the closing comment.
My experience of the MIPC is that I'm working at an academic institute, PGI-MER, as I said, many of our orthopedicians shed off patients and they don't want because they are overburdened. So my experience of MIPC is there. I won't say great, huge, but I would say every month we do around 20 to 25 patients of MIPC for OA knee, 25 to 30 patients of MIPC for OA knee per month. And I do not have cooled RF with me. So we do pulse radio frequency and we do intra-articular PRP have been done, but I haven't seen good results with PRP. Maybe my technique or maybe the procedure done was not adequate or adequate, or despite that, maybe we do a very stringent RCT. So I do not know this. About closing comment as beginning, we said...
Ma'am, not right now. Closing we'll do just right now. It's a poll time. So I will share the poll first. Then we'll do the closing comments.
Okay. Poll time.
Okay. So I will now withdraw the co-host permissions from both of you. And so that you can also vote. So guys, please don't go away. Just vote for the winner. Today we have to declare a winner. It is just so that, you know... we just remain as enthu as we were when we just joined in. So I'm launching the poll. All of you will have to just, it's an anonymous poll and you guys can just vote and just tell me or tell us whom you think has won the debate today. So I will consider this as only maybe 20 seconds more. Just type the, just mark the answer and then it's done. I've already received around, I've received 18 of you have already done. They're voting 19. So good, 20. Yes. So please keep on answering and keep on marking your vote. It's a quite close contest. I'm seeing it's 50-50 as of now. Exactly 50-50. We have good division. So very close contest going on. So, okay. Those of you who are here for the first time, please, I have posted the links for our Facebook page, YouTube channel, WhatsApp group. Please join us, give your comments, valuable suggestions. If you have any suggestions, please mail me mumbaipainschool@gmail.com and I'll be happy to answer. So, last 10 seconds before we end the polling. Okay, most of you have voted. I have got around 70% of people who have voted. Guys, please vote. So I'm again posting the links in the chat box. Just 5 seconds to go. I'll end the poll. Okay. I'm going to end the poll and that's it. Okay. So I'm sharing these results now. So these are the results. It's quite closely contested poll. And I think so today speaker against the motion, Dr. Babita Ghai has won, but I think it's quite a 48-52%, just matter of one vote. So it's quite a close call and I'm very happy actually to see most of us are pain physicians and still we are you know, considering this as an academic discussion as well. So now I will go on to both the speakers one by one for their closing comments. Before the consultation start, I think consultations have started here in the comment box. And before you know, they start anymore or they continue, I'll just like to close the debate with the closing comments from Dr. Uttam first and then Dr. Pipita.
So my closing comment is that if the patient is of grade 3, if he's in gray zone, you must try the PRP. PRP giving good results in these stages. And if you, and cooled RF is fantastic, no doubt about it. But if you don't have cooled RF, you can use a bipolar. If you can manage that second lead in the pottery, this thing, foot pedal, you get that attachment and you can use the cooled RF, bipolar. And that also gives equally good results. We don't have studies, but we should conduct that kind of studies to compare with cooled RF with the bipolar. So in the stage 4, I don't have any doubt about it that it is a surgical this thing. If patient comes to me for the stage 4, I just refer that patient to the surgery. Unless he is just refusing for the surgery.
So over to you, Mavita ma'am.
I think Uttam has already spoken for me about as a close comment. I say clearly the indication for TKR and indication of MIPSI are different. MIPSI definitely constitute a continuum of protocol or the step of the step of management for OA knee. And TKR has no replacement as MIPSI. MIPSI should be used when indicated. And it is required in many of the OA knees, especially up from grade 1, 2, and 3.
Great. So thank you both of you for your kind comments. And of course, for the great efforts which you have taken to prepare.
Add on last one thing is, yes, being an academician, frankly speaking, nobody can convince me stating that I have seen the good results by the expert opinion. Unless you have done a stringent follow-up with the stringent outcome assessment. So agreed. Dr. Nandita has mentioned that she has seen good results with PRP. I was also expecting the same, but results were similar. Dr. Uttam says he has seen beautiful results and very good results with cooled RF. Good. But we need to be seeing how many patients, how have they been followed, and is that been compared with other modalities?
Right. So we need a lot of studies from the budding pain physician to conduct all these studies and publish it. So we will have a solid data.
Yes. And we from India can produce really good data because by mere number of patients we have. But it takes a lot of effort to conduct any RCT.
I have done quite a few this thing cooled RF in grade 4 and it doesn't work at all. It may work in one knee and it may not work in other knee because this was just a patient's this thing. They don't want to go ahead with the surgery and they said insisted to do something for the knee, but this cooled RF doesn't work in stage 4, so don't attempt that thing.
Okay, great. So I think we will have lots and lots of stuff to come here and lots of discussions going on, everything. But the overall, it was a great effort from both the speakers. Thank you, Dr. Uttam sir, for sparing your time, especially with the the personal commitments which you had to do, and that even increases the respect I have for you. So thank you so much. And thank you, Babita ma'am, for taking this difficult topic. And I still remember when you said that, I don't want to take against the motion, I want to take for the motion. But I knew that you would be able to do good justice, I'm sure sometime we'll do this with one of our orthopedician friend, on the other side, and then it will be like real dhamal and even better arguments, counter arguments, and we'll know that side of the story. But I personally felt that we as pain physicians were not very prepared. So first we needed to do something to prepare ourselves in a much better way so that then we can have more and more academic discussions and collaborations with our orthopedic colleagues to give the best results to our patients. So thank you so much, both of you.
Thank you, Siddharth. Thank you for, you know, doing such a wonderful job.
Thank you. So now for going on to the next steps, join our mailing list, guys. We have a WhatsApp group. I have already posted the link in the chat box. And we are coming with a webinar on NEPA and MIPSIS. Block the dates. It will be on 3rd and 4th September. Of course, we'll be continuing with our journal clubs on Fridays as we do always. And this is just a sneak peek. So we'll be covering lots of these procedures as well as the evidence-based recommendations in this webinar. So stay tuned for more announcements and details. They'll follow very, very soon. So I'm actively working on this as of now. So with these words, I will like to thank all the participants, especially the audience, without which this would not have been possible. Of course, the speakers, and I will just like to end the session now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Siddharth. Siddharth, can I take this opportunity to invite our budding pain physicians for one of the course, which is EPIN course, which is an executive executive program on neuromodulation, which you had attended last time. The same course from the William Harvey Institute will be conducted on 20 and 21st of September, as well as 27th and 28th of September. This will be an online course on neuromodulation, covering all aspects of neuromodulation. If anybody wants, I will just place my email here and they can contact me. And this will be a certificate course, which can provide them base for next year master's course in half online and half offline at London.
So very nice course, guys. If you were even remotely interested in neuromodulation, so I think this is one of the best courses around. And increase your knowledge first before you put on the first stimulator. And I think they've got some really good faculties, and I'm speaking from personal experience. I attended this course recently. It's quite nice.
Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye.